Good evening, friends. Welcome to Pendle Hill. It's so nice to see a good turnout this evening for our friend George Lakey. And I suspect that a number of you have already read his book, Viking Economics, How the Scandinavians Got It Right and How We Can Too! Exclamation point. So George is here to provide us some insights from that book. My guess is that he'll be very responsive to questions, as I have seen him do this before, and it's a very lively talk because the questions are all the things that are bubbling up in our minds and hearts. It's my custom to put the commercial announcements first, so welcome to our live streaming audience at home as well. Next, first Monday will be on the 2nd of January when our own IT person and video critic, David Butterworth, presents Quakers in the Movies, an illustrated talk with David Butterworth and organic popcorn. This particular revolution will not be live streamed because of the film. So I urge you all to put January 2nd on your calendar for rather a fun evening. It's apparently when New Year's is being celebrated, quote unquote, because it falls on a Sunday this coming year. It should be a lot of fun, and it goes along with his book, Celluloid Friends. After our evening talk with George tonight, he'll be available for selling books in the lobby. Please purchase your book from the bookstore first, and then come and get George to give you his autograph in it. And on the 15th of December, well, and then after we let him go and after we've ingested some refreshments, George is not only a world-traveling facilitator and trainer and scholar, author, he is a magician at the keyboard playing Broadway show tunes that we can sing along to. So yes, if you wish to stay for that, please do. It'll be fun. On the 15th of December, Brent Bill, who is the is a well-known author, is going to be doing a book signing and reading from his book, Holy Silence, in an evening we're calling Finding Silence in a Noisy Season. That will be at 7:30 here in the barn with the bookstore open on Thursday, December 15th, 7:30 to 9. For those of you who may have heard about our conference, Moral Economy, all of our plenaries are on our YouTube channel, Pendle Hill USA, including George's talk. And for many of you may be involved in more or more extraordinary activism than you have been, because it's necessary under present circumstances. And our two of our friends who are here and present and presenting at the conference, Lynn Iser and Mordecai Liebling, will be doing a training on The Great Turning, Becoming Vibrant Elders in Our Emerging World. So even if you're not elder, and even if you're already vibrant, you could still benefit from this workshop this coming weekend. We still have spaces available. There's a brochure out in the lobby for that. So having already touched on January 1st, we also still have space in Carl Mittleman's workshop this year, The Music and Cultural Politics of 20th Century Latin America. As many of you who know Carl will know that he is an extraordinary teacher and showman, and so everyone really enjoys his New Year's retreats, which run from the 28th of December through January 1st. If you are local, as I know many of you are, you may also be interested in an alcohol-free New Year's Eve evening here at Pendle Hill. We're going to have a 9-piece Latin band in the barn, and as well as our, you know, homemade hors d'oeuvres and a homemade locally sourced dinner and our midnight meeting for worship and ice cream social. It's just fun and games from about 4:30 till midnight. So that you can register for that online. Wow, that was a lot of commercials. I'm sorry, George. Let's get down to the main business at hand. George Lakey, as many of you know him, has led more than 1,500 workshops on 5 continents, taught at colleges, most recently as the Lang Professor at Swarthmore. He was the developer of the Global Nonviolent Database, along with the students at Swarthmore, that document all different kinds of civil nonviolent resistance and its successes so that those are available widely around the world. He's led other activist projects on local, state, national, and national levels, and authored 8 books, of course, the most recent of which is the book we're going to talk about tonight, Viking Economics. But he's also the co-author of Grassroots and Nonprofit Leadership, A Guide for Organizations in Changing Times, and as we are in them. I would also recommend something that I really enjoy reading, and not only George's columns, but all of the columns in a weekly blog called wagingnonviolence.org. Wagingnonviolence.org just keeps its finger on the pulse of the issues that are affecting activists, particularly those who are concerned about nonviolent change. And he's a member of Central Philadelphia Monthly Meeting. Let's give George a warm welcome. It's so nice to have you back after only one day's absence.
That would imply that I should be incautious.
Yes.
Bold.
Perhaps.
Take
yes.
risks. Are you with me on that? Do I get support for that? The way I take a risk with this particular thing, I've been doing book tours since July when the book came out, is I invite people to ask the hardest questions that they can ask. And that way, I get to risk every single time that I talk about this book. And I'm so glad that you invited me back again for Monday Night Lecture, because I have a long history of doing Monday Night Lectures at Pendle Hill. And the tradition it includes Broadway singing afterward. And it's always a toss-up about whether I have more fun sharing during the lecture or more fun doing the singing. And I hope you'll stick around, and any of you who like to sing. And we'll see how that turns out tonight as well. Whoa, this book is so amazing to me because I'm so pent up about it. I'll tell a little bit about how it came to be written. And then mostly, we'll get to hear from you what your hard questions are and what you want to probe about. But the way it came about was I fell in love. That's the origin of this book. I fell in love with a Norwegian. And I had only the vaguest idea where Norway was at the time. How old was I? I was 19 years old, always been geographically challenged. And it really burned me up. I met her in an American Friends Service Committee summer project. And there was another guy who was interested in her, And he not only knew where Norway was, he knew where her hometown was. And it was so unfair. But I got her. It took a couple of years to actually marry her because she needed to finish college. She was a foreign student here and go back home. And then I needed to wait to get the money together to be able to go over and marry her. But 5 days off the boat, we were married. And then the adventure started, the adventure that resulted in this book. For one thing, I needed to learn the language. I was really curious, what was it that the priest said that I agreed to during the service? So I was very curious about that. And I was also curious to really get to know her family members who did not speak English. So if I was going to have a relationship with them, I thought it was really important that I learn Norwegian. So I did that intensive Norwegian course for a while. And Barrett and I thought it would be very cool to move from the town that where we were married to Oslo, because that's the capital city and where so much is going on. And that's also one of the places where there's a university. And Barrett said, you know, you could go to university for free. Well, I'm a skeptical American, and actually the book will you'll find reflects that. And so that first matriculation fee day, I will never forget, because I put down my matriculation fee at the office there in Oslo, and it was $14. And I waited for the next thing to happen. But there was no next thing to happen. It wasn't any more money than that. And I was so puzzled. This was the first of my stranger in a strange land experiences, right? So I turned to a friend that I was making, a Norwegian student, and I said, Sigurd, tell me, what sense does it make that a country should underwrite the higher education of the students in the country? Like, why does that make any sense? And he said, George, look at it this way. Wouldn't you say that brain power is an economic resource to a country? Well, yes, I would say that. Okay, well then he said, what sense would it make for a country not fully to develop its economic resources and to put a price tag on the development of brain power so that it reduces the potential of its economic development? Oh, he had me there. And I got to thinking on the way back to our little apartment. This Norwegian thing is deeper than I expected, because I had a story about this free education. I had a story that Norwegians were probably idealistic. They like to take idealistic flings, you know, and it surely promotes equality to have free higher education, and it supports individual freedom. That's a good thing. So they probably make it up in other ways, but this is their fling, you know. And I had no idea that it was actually also a very pragmatic decision to boost their economy, to make sure that all the talented youngsters who could use that could go to, you know, undergraduate and graduate school and medical school and law school and ballet school and you name it. All of that stuff would be available so that they could develop their brain power. So that was my first introduction to this, the deeper side of things. And all through the year, I kept running into that over and over and over. Barrett said, well, you know, we need a family doctor so that if we get sick, we have a doctor. And in Norway, we love having our own primary care person. So she found a family doctor. And sure enough, that winter, I got flu. And in those days, I always got the flu every winter. That seemed to be a part of my lifestyle. And that year, it was particularly bad and hard for me to get out of bed. So the doctor came and did a house call. And then he asked for money, so we gave him some money, and he gave us a little chit, and he said, so when you're well, you could just take this to the office, you know, the office, the healthcare office, and you'll see a little window there, and you'll give them the slip, and then they'll give you your money back. Mine is a very small service charge, and that's it. Oh, where's the bureaucracy? Because some Americans, before I left this country, had said, beware, it's called a welfare state because it's full of bureaucracy and all these obstacles and difficulties to access resources, services. Where's the bureaucracy? What's going on? And so it was fun in researching the book to catch myself up on how things are going with regard to healthcare over there. And I found out that not only do they take care of everyone in Norway with their healthcare system, even to the point where if you happen to live north of the Arctic Circle, Norway is a very, very long and skinny country. Very long. If you take the bottom of the country and use it as a pivot and take the top and wheel it around, it comes to Rome. So it's a very long and skinny country. If you're at the top and you get a brain tumor that requires a particular kind of surgery that's only available at the bottom of the country at the University of Oslo's hospital, then the health service flies you to Oslo so you could get the surgery that you need. And that's an of course we would do that. So I thought, well, that must be a very expensive proposition to provide that level of care for the population. So then I found out through doing the research that they only pay 2/3 of what the United States pays for our healthcare system. And they cover everyone. And as you know, we have tens of millions of people who don't even have the beginning of health insurance. And other people who do have health insurance but nevertheless have a hard time accessing the care that they need. 2/3. We pay 1/3 more per capita than they do, and we have a shoddy system with regard to access, except for people who pay for the Cadillac healthcare plans and that kind of thing. So this is very interesting. So again, what's going on under there? I find out they believe that a healthy workforce is a more productive workforce. Huh? And therefore, that pays off economically. So that means they get two benefits out of having a superior healthcare system. They have the benefit of paying less for it because it's more efficient. It's way more efficient to tax people and put that money into a healthcare system and then distribute the care as needed. That's the more efficient way. 2/3 compared with what we pay. And second, though, also they have a healthier population. And one of the payoffs to that is longer life expectancy. But then, of course, what about all those people living a long time? Well, of course, there's universal pension. So everybody automatically has a right to pension. And older people have an opportunity to decide, when it comes to needing assistance in my old age, would I rather go into a retirement community and get my assistance that way, or would I rather have help coming to my home and I age in place and people come in and cook for me or clean or do healthcare, home healthcare, that kind of thing. Because I can make that choice either way I want to go is how I go. So that means that people have built in a degree of security that makes it less stressful to live in Norway than here. But then it turns out less stressed people tend to be more productive economically. Now, this was actually a discovery by a man who some of you will know the name of, Gunnar Myrdal, because he did a major race relations study here in this country. Swedish guy who did his PhD economics degree trying to figure out what is the nature of human beings after all with regard to economics. And his idea that he came up with, which he then got the Economics Nobel Prize for, was that human beings actually like to work. And given a chance, they'll work, and they'll work well. And at first, when I ran into that, I thought, And then I remembered, because I'm a great-grandfather, I have watched so many little children with toys and blocks and in the woods building forts and so on and so on. I've seen so many children in their freedom working, building, projects. And that's our nature. And Murdoch said, the job of an economy, therefore, is to design jobs so that people can get the satisfaction of a job well done. I mean, if you design a lot of jobs where people don't get the satisfaction, of course, then you do have to drive people to work and beat up on them if they don't in some way, threaten them with starvation or whatever. But if you provide jobs for everyone and those jobs are of a sensible design, then people are happy to work and they will be productive. Especially if enhanced by having the training that enables them to do their job really well, go to school for it or whatever, and to have time off so they're not highly stressed. So Norwegians work fewer hours than anybody else in Europe. In fact, while I was there, a story I tell in the book, some of you already know the story, is sitting in a living room, because every time I go back to Norway, I hang out with the family. I'm no longer married to this Norwegian, but I adopted her family and they adopted me. So whenever I go there, I always hang out with the family. And there was this time I was sitting with everybody. We were drinking coffee, of course, that's very important to Norwegians, and eating cakes. And somebody said, oh, I just read that there's another step being taken in terms of reducing the work week. They found an occupational group that they decided to do a study of. This was an occupational group that was typically getting 40-hour week jobs. And they told them that they should try doing the same amount of work in 30 hours. And so they were studied, you know, in the outcome and the output and so on and so on. And the study discovered that they actually put out more work in 30 hours than they had previously been in 40 hours. So people were not shocked or surprised. It was, kind of makes sense. When I think about my job, I could work fewer hours and get more done. And so somebody said, I wonder when they'll get around to my job. And there's a variety of jobs in the room. Yeah, I know, what about my job? And it occurred to one of these cousins that I hadn't participated in the discussion very much. So lately. So she turned to me and said, well, George, how is it in your country? Like, do you folks like to, just have less hours put into work, like long vacations, that kind of thing? Wealthy, enormously wealthy country, you probably have bigger, longer vacations than we do, stuff like that. And we only have 5 weeks paid vacation, And I said, well, actually, a lot of people in my country don't have any paid vacation. And those who do, a lot of them have 1 week, and then probably a typical amount is 2 weeks paid vacation. And I see jaws dropping open around the room. And this woman who was interrogating me got tears in her eyes of compassion. It's like, oh. And she said, well, and then I could see her. She was struggling. Well, there are cultural differences. We Norwegians have to be broad-minded and understand there's a variety of cultures in the world. And maybe this is their approach. And I shouldn't be judgmental. So I said, oh, okay. So she said, well, maybe your people don't like to have hobbies and time to play with the children. You'd rather work. Maybe it's just like a cultural preference. And I said, no, it's not that we don't want time to do those things. It's that we don't know we can. And for me, that was a major breakthrough in understanding my people as compared with them. They were sitting in this living room talking with such an easy assumption that if it's rational to work 35 hours a week instead of 40 for the 40-hour week pay, or 30 hours instead of 40, or whatever the study shows, if it makes sense, then we'll do it. That's how things will be. Just an automatic assumption that the people are in charge. Even though I was not sitting in a room full of heads of political parties. None of my relatives, Norwegian relatives, is all that politically active. But they just assumed, well, that's how things are. When, what we want is what we get. I thought, whoa, it gets deeper and deeper and deeper. That there's really a different set of assumptions going on in relation to the economy. People have freedom and have equality, yes, to a remarkable degree, probably historically the most remarkable degree that any peoples have had equality and freedom. But also this sense of democracy, this sense of empowerment that they had. It's just amazing. So there I was that first year, just having my mind boggled. And then we came back. For one thing, I didn't have an undergraduate degree yet, and we thought we ought to tidy that up. So we came back to Philadelphia to finish my degree, and I was eager to tell my friends some of the things that I'd been learning from this year in Norway, right? And I would start to tell, and they would change the subject. And I would start to tell somebody else, and they would change the subject. Whoa, this is deep. These stories are so interesting to me. Why aren't they interesting to them? And of course, we stayed in touch with the relatives back and forth. We did settle here, but back and forth. I got to work in Sweden, work in Denmark. So I'd have stories from there too. And Americans, just old friends of mine, just could not be less interested in my stories. So I finally thought, George, stop frustrating yourself. Why do you keep trying to tell these stories? Well, you're a storyteller, but give it up. They're not interested. Fast forward, 2008. I'd hear some people say, oh, I wonder, what's the next? Lehman Brothers collapses, financial. I'd say, it's interesting what they did in Sweden when a similar thing happened, when the bankers went wild and there was a kind of bubble based on real estate speculation, and the bubble burst and there was a calamity. But I was very tentative because I had been bitten so many times, right? And the response I would get would be, oh, well, what did the Swedes do? You mean you care? You mean you're interested in somebody else's experience outside the United States? Because I'd come to the conclusion that Americans were just so arrogant that why should they listen to stories from elsewhere, because the United States is the best, we're the greatest. And why should they listen to their friend George tell about something that's being done in Sweden, because if it's a really good idea, it would be done in the United States, right? So all that arrogance that I'd been experiencing for decade after decade after decade was falling away. Because in 2008, Americans started to get humble. We didn't have all the answers after all. So I thought, it's time to write a book. And that's the origin of the book. That's when I got really excited about writing, because I thought, if my people, and I'm a fiercely American-identified person, if my people are actually interested, then I want to spread the word. So if tonight I seem to you a little too enthusiastic or like overexcited or something, just consider I'm so pent up, because all those years when people didn't want to hear anything about those countries, and now I get a chance. So that's, please forgive me for any overenthusiasm. I should get back here and look in my yellowed notes or something. I don't want to overwhelm you with my enthusiasm, so I'll just explain. It's because I'm such a pent-up guy. Okay, well, I would like to give you maximum chance for you to raise the questions you want to raise, and a couple of reasons why I think you might want to ask hard questions. Number one, we are in a kind of political trouble right now. I think probably most people in this room would agree. And so the social movements that have, the insurrections that have been happening lately from Occupy on, then Black Lives Matters and the Dreamers and these different things that have been going, the divestment movement, the campus divestment movement and so on, these things that have been coming up more, and now this big victory out at Standing Rock, how about that? As another wonderful example, yes, amazing, 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 amazing people. So there is all this ferment already in our society, but it looks to me as though the victory of Trump will stir that up all the more. Do you find people like who haven't been that busy lately, maybe active, just, oh, what can we do? What can we do? What can we do? Okay, so this is actually a wonderful time for building social movements. But one of the things that I know from my study of social movements is social movements get farther if they are pursuing a vision of what they want. You can only get so far in reaction to what you don't want. Ooh, boo, boo, hiss, hiss. Only goes so far. People tend to burn out. Outrage, outrage, you know. There's only so much outrage we can do. But if we have a positive vision of what we're after, we tend to work in a more steadfast way, and also in a more grounded way, more practical way. Oh, well then how do we get what it is we want? Okay, so this book comes out at a very fortunate time, because one way to look at what they've done in Norway, Sweden, Denmark, and Iceland is we could look at that as a positive vision of what we want. But you wouldn't want to do that unless you query it, unless you interrogate it, right? Like, huh, is it really a suitable vision? Is it suitable for the United States? And is it advanced enough to really work for? And so on. But I see the book as a possible vision that we could, that would enable us to unite our various movements. Because unity is a very positive thing for winning, right? If we want to win a better society, it's great to have unity. Division is not great. And it may be that Norway, Sweden, and Denmark, and Iceland, the what economists call the Nordic model, represent a vision that a lot of people could unite on. Another indication of that is that the Movement for Black Lives on August 1st, this is the organization kind of cobbled together to bring some coherence to these grassroots stirrings all over the country by black people with white allies who and people other people of color allies who are concerned about police behavior and that kind of thing, right? So that Movement for Black Lives actually came out with a vision on August 1st, got attention to the New York Times, a number of mass media organs, and in that vision, when I read it right away, I thought, oh, I'm so curious because visions attract me, right? And when I read it, tears came to my eyes because it was in alignment with the Nordic model. There's a lot more economics in it than I expected, and it was in alignment with the Nordic model. I thought, whoa, this is profound, because it's very tempting when doing vision work to count on the imagination, basically. Oh, wouldn't it be great to have that, and that, and that. But the trouble with the imagination, I love reading utopias, but the thing about utopias is it becomes a matter of speculation. Well, is it workable? And you can just spend an awful lot of time, is it workable? Well, that's a great idea, John, but is it workable? You know, like that. Well, by putting their economic underpinning structure in a context that is in alignment with the Nordic model, they are connecting with something that's been working. It's not just a matter of speculation, because the Nordic model has been working and very successfully for 60 years plus. So that's not just, wonder if that thing would work. Well, that model had, in fact, those countries, part of the fun of doing the book was looking at the various international ratings. I don't know if you're aware that there are more and more ratings. You can find out where the country's on the happiness index, even on the happiness index. So I don't know, maybe next it'll be where our country's on the rainbow and bunny rabbits index. I don't know, there's just so many indices. But of course there are indices on preventable deaths and so on as ways of understanding health measures and so on. Worker productivity, I already referred to that. So there are all these different ways of rating countries. Well, if you could spend an evening sometime just Googling and finding those, and you'll find on the top of the international charts comparing countries that the Nordic countries play tag at the top. So this year, Denmark will be the happiest country, but next year it'll be Iceland, and then the next year it'll be Norway, like that. The index on how countries are doing in addressing climate change, for example, the Nordic countries play around at the top. Norway has gotten a dip lately because of its extraction of oil and gas. But the other countries don't have oil and gas, so they stay there up at the top. In other words, when it comes to, well, should we trust this vision because it probably wouldn't work because, you know, it's just speculation. Well, it's got a track record. So that's another reason, I think, to consider it as a possible vision for our work. So it might be the kind of thing you'd want to get people behind. And it might recommend the Movement for Black Lives vision to you, and you might want to get organizations that you know to sign up. The AFSC has already signed up, American Friends Service Committee. And you might want your meeting to sign up and so on. One of the things that thrills me is the idea of lots and lots of white groups signing up in support of a black originated vision for our country. Yes. Endorsed it.
Endorsed
it. That is made a public statement.
Black Lives Matter platform?
Yeah. Made a public statement saying they agree. Right. They call their vision both a vision and a platform. Those words. Yeah. Yeah. So endorsing. So those are some reasons why if the Nordic model made sense to you, it could be politically important for you as a political person, as a citizen in this country. And if on the other hand it doesn't make sense to you, then you definitely shouldn't buy it. So that's why I'm hoping that you will interrogate me intensely and push me around and see what you come up with. So to prepare you to do that, I'd like you to turn to a neighbor and just come up with the hardest possible things that you can come up with. And then we'll have at it. So turn to each other, not you two, because you two know each other way too well. So you need to turn over to somebody else. Please do that.
Also, before you ask those questions, I'll come around with the microphone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, let's find out what we've got. Oh, hand is already up. Okay, so let's, we're bound to have some really juicy questions by now. And John will come around with the microphone because this is live streamed. And we want to be respectful of the people who are tuning in. Thank you for tuning in, folks. So, Lena's got a question. Look how high that hand is. Look at the enthusiasm.
Are you trying to keep people quiet? I can't tell. Shall we start with?
Yeah.
Did you want to start on these sides of the room and then move our way this way?
We could take, or we could do that, or to reduce the mobility, we could see if maybe there's a cluster of two or three in a cluster. We could try the cluster.
A cluster approach. So do you want to take three?
But it looks like a really formidable question. I better.
Do you want to take three? George, do you want to take three or four from over here then? And then
if it turns out that people, yeah.
So you talked about the power of unity. And my question relates to the fact that I think a lot of folks are questioning right now how much unity there is in this country. It feels like there's so much polarization. How much unity was there in the Scandinavian countries to sort of establish the Nordic model?
Such a great question. Yeah, how much unity was there? The four countries have somewhat different histories, of course, unique histories. And so I'll talk about the two that were closest in time, which were Norway and Sweden, in terms of when things really got cooking. All right. And that was in the 20s and 30s when those two countries got cooking. And that was also the most polarized time. Yeah, very striking, very surprising. That was a time in Norway, for example, when Nazis would be marching on the street, you know, full out with swastikas and spouting their anti-Semitic racism and that kind of thing. And also, though, I mean, so that's one side of the spectrum, right? And then the other side of the spectrum, the communist side, there was an active communist party that was being responsive to Moscow, you know, sort of dancing to the tune of Moscow. And so that's a pretty big spread. That's even more of a spread than we've got, I would say, politically. And despite that tremendous polarization that those two societies were going through at the time, they also made their breakthroughs. At that time, for Sweden, it was 1931 when they brought down the government and created the situation for creating the new model. And in Norway, it was 1936 when they were able to make that shift. So it's curious in a way because you would think, well, polarization just makes such a mess. How can you make a breakthrough? And at first, that puzzled me. And then I got to thinking, well, but George, you know something about U.S. history. What was true in the 20th century in the U.S.? Well, the 30s, big polarization, right? You had Father Coughlin on the radio every week preaching fascism and so on. It was a pretty lively fascist scene here in the U.S. and also lively communist theme as seen and a pretty strong anarchist scheme. And the Ku Klux Klan in the 30s was very strong and so on. So it was a very polarized time for the United States. And then again for the U.S. in the 60s, very polarized. National Rifle Association was gaining membership like crazy. Ku Klux Klan really flying high and so on. Very, very polarized time. And we had big breakthroughs in the 30s. Right, we wouldn't have Social Security. And big breakthroughs in the 60s and the 70s, the EPA, just all kinds of good things happened. So it seems like maybe we ought to thank Donald Trump for articulating and voicing some of the polarization so we can enter a period of awesome polarization and have a chance for a breakthrough as well, based on that. In any case, I published an article about this for Yes Magazine, and the editor told me that got tremendous response, and her next question was, we need a follow-up article on, that was also true in Germany. There was big polarization in the 20s and 30s, right? And also in Italy. And what they got in Germany, of course, was Hitler, and what they got in Italy was Mussolini. So it's not like polarization guarantees you will have a wonderful progressive breakthrough, right? You can have a different kind of breakthrough. This is really grim. So then the question becomes, how do you navigate a big polarization situation so that you can make the breakthrough on the progressive side rather than just get caught up on the negative?
This seems like a direct lead into the question that I was planning to pose for you, if you don't mind my taking the prerogative of the mic. Part of the groundwork that you laid in the book, in your chapters that talked about the historical development, so there was not only polarization, but there was a history of what I would call deep democracy at play in the countries. Even though there was an oligarchy at the top, the union movement was very strong in both of those countries, and there was a strong cooperative movement because each little village had cooperatives and they were isolated from other villages by the fjords and so forth. So that there was a sense that people already had some kind of control over their daily lives. And so I'm wondering, with the decline of unionization in this country and even the kind of employees kind of becoming part-time or independent contractors and not a very strong cooperative movement, what would be the vehicle of the deep democracy that you would see being the force that might carry the polarization to the new vision?
Right, it's such a great question. The advantage of the union movement is that there's a considerable amount of internal pressure for unity. Right, because including in the workplace itself, the people get to work together daily in a particular union, and so they get to know each other well and are used to having each other's backs in a particular way. And then politically, it's easier to have each other's backs. And so it would be way more convenient for us if there hadn't been the concerted effort made after World War II to do in the unions, a movement that's still going on from the right to destroy the unions. They're still working at that, right? The public opinion, the public employees unions and the teachers unions are constantly getting hammered now.
The strongest that are still left. Exactly.
So the agenda on the, from the right since World War II has been destroy the unions, destroy the unions. And they've gotten pretty far on it. With very little solidarity from middle class people, I would say, actually. It's been like we've been watching this hammering against working class people and not doing much about having their back. So it's a kind of ironic twist insofar as middle class liberals would now like to have that degree of political power on their side or on our side. And but when were we there when we were needed at the time? So it's an ironical kind of challenge that we now experience. So on the other hand, the U.S. is different from those countries. And one of the ways we're different is that the movements here seem to pop up out of our diversity. So in 2006, there's millions of people in the movement for immigrant rights, for example. Millions of people. It was the civil rights movement of that time, right? And now, of course, a new civil rights movement on the part of black people. And the Occupy phenomenon, you know. So it seems like we don't actually need to have the kind of union format in which people are, you know, collect memberships and get people organized step by step by step, and then have a strike. That kind of orderly procedure doesn't seem so important in the U.S. in order to get a lot of energy going and a lot of power going. The downside, though, of the way we seem to do things more these days is that how do we get the unity across those lines? So maybe the Dreamers are on one track, and the divestment, young people in colleges are on another track. Maybe there's not much connection, right? How do we get the unity that we want? So there are efforts that are under the radar, and therefore you wouldn't be seeing in the paper or hearing on TV about that are putting leaderships together of those various movements so that they can get to know each other and learn how to trust each other. That's under the radar. And then another thing that I think is encouraging in that front is that there's, I believe, a growing consciousness that a vision could be a source of unity. And I think that's one reason why the movement for Black Lives was so quick to develop a vision and put it out. Because those of you who remember the Civil Rights Movement, it was, well, they never quite really got there. Bayard Rustin, who a Quaker African-American chief lieutenant for, not lieutenant, but strategist for Dr. King, used to just beat on people in the movement, in the Civil Rights Movement. We need a vision, we need a vision. And actually his model also was the Nordic model. We need a social democratic vision that puts an economic floor under this movement. In fact, I remember he was hugely formative for me, very influential with me. And I remember him saying over and over, if we don't get this economic thing right, in 50 years, we're going to still have terrible racism in our country. He was right. So he kept beating on Dr. King and all the different leaders to bring forth a vision that would support the United Auto Workers and the unions and white middle class allies and so on to be able to band together behind them. And they never really did get one. The closest to it was a freedom budget, and that wasn't quite. That was a step, but it took forever, and it didn't get that much unity. That's one reason why I think it's so important for us to do vision work now. And the fact that the movement for Black Lives, after, 2 years? I mean, that's a very new movement. Isn't it only a couple of years since Ferguson? It's just like, boom. And suddenly, boom, already they have a vision out. So I think it makes sense for us, all of us who want progress in this country, to really support that as quickly as possible in order to be building the unity that can't be gotten so easily from just turning to AFL-CIO. And having said all that, I should still remind us that the labor movement is the closest thing to a mass organized progressive movement that we do have in this country, right? And they were the first ones to come out against the Iraq War, before the American Library Association or any other middle class group that I know. They were the first to mass national movement to come out against that war. They were the first to come out for unilateral withdrawal from the Afghanistan War. Very progressive association, segment of the population. So because it's not the lion that it used to be, it's maybe a little too easy to discount it. You know what I mean? Yes. You're close enough to John. We'll call you part of the cluster.
If you hold it right on your lower lip, you can even rest it there.
I'm resting it. Thank you. So this summer, right before the DNC, there was a thing called the People's Convention in Philly, and it was a really great. It was like literally the day before the DNC. And there was a tremendous organized program put together to create planks of a platform. We all sat in tables, and I haven't heard anything since that day, but there was an amazing amount of information, vision. It was all done in World Cafe format, starting in the morning throughout the afternoon. And there were 7 questions that were answered by there were probably, I don't know, if there were 10 or 12 tables, each with 8 people. And we completed these series of 7 questions throughout the day. And so I feel like that information is so important to something like this.
Great. Awesome.
And I it's something I could do is, I don't have it. I haven't heard it. You know, it's done through Facebook. It was like on a Facebook post.
They created the event.
We went to the event, and I haven't heard a word since then, but it was this past summer. It's something I'd like to look into. And
if you would. Would you look into it and let us know if it's been...
Okay.
Because that could be like an agenda for research, right? To look into the specific things and then project them farther and so on.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good news. That's very good news. Yeah. And then it'd be fun to take that and compare it with the Movement for Black Lives vision and see how much overlap and so on, right? That's great. Thank you. There's somebody right next to her as well. Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
I was based off of this wonderful question that you asked, sir. Who could we be unified behind? I immediately thought, oh, women. So, what an wonderful opportunity in our country right now to deal with a rocky road for women. To lead the vision and help create the vision forward. Mm-hmm. And I wondered for the countries that you looked into, was there already an egalitarian relationship that the culture had that carried forward, or do you know of any women's movements that aided in this progressive government that they now enjoy?
It's great. Great question. If we go back to the ancient Vikings, which the title of my book kind of invites us to do, and every once in a while I do a little dance in my book about the ancient Vikings, it was, as far as, it's so hard to know for sure, but it looks as though it was more equal with regard to the genders than other peoples of that period. And one speculation is that with all those men running off on boats, the women were left behind to run the communities, make the decisions. They had they owned property in their own names, in their own right, and so on. And and when the men came back, whatever was done was done. So it may have encouraged a kind of women's uplift. Also, women had the right to divorce men. Which in that time was breathtaking, 1,000 years ago, but of course they fell by Ibsen's time. Ibsen was writing plays about the subjugation of women and so on, and so by the time a century ago, when they were starting to put together this batch of movements, there were certainly women playing important roles in a behind-the-scenes way, but not in the out-front way, except with regard to women's suffrage. And they did get the right to vote before we did and before most countries did in Scandinavia. One reason why I wish I knew more about how much power they were really exerting is because it seemed like every time an inch was given to women, they took a mile. And so next thing you know, it was half the cabinet, And then it was the prime minister was a woman. And it was on and on and on. Women were, of course, held back in terms of public life by the responsibility of motherhood, right? So then one of the early parts of the Nordic model was affordable childcare. And then the next step was family leave, paid family leave, and longer paid family leave. But then people noticed, women especially noticed, but then the men, they persuaded the men to notice that it was mostly women who were taking the leave and taking care of the children. Why shouldn't it be the men who were doing that? So they instituted a policy that men, a couple, a heterosexual couple, would get a portion. It varies in different countries, but let's say 11 months, roughly. That's not rough. 12 months. That's rougher. I mean, 11 months is rough. 11 months in general. That's what I'm looking for. Thank you. Whoa. So let's say 12 months. Then they would say, okay, so 3 months of that has to be taken by the man in the heterosexual pair. And if the man won't take it, then they lose it. So that puts the pressure on men to take more and more and more, and so on and so on. So they're moving right along. 40% of corporate boards have to be women. So then they did a study. They're chronic studiers of themselves. And so they found that the corporations that raced to get their 40% first, because it became a rivalry, you know, my corporation's faster than yours. So the ones that got their 40% women first and over the mark, if possible, also showed higher profits and greater productivity than the ones that were the slower ones to get, you know, that. And now there are, of course, over 50% in many corporations. So it looks to me like there's way more than I know about how much sort of leadership from the side or from the elbow that was going on, because it seems like every time there was a little step, then it became a big step.
You mentioned the diversity, and it strikes me that the Nordic model worked where there was not the same kind of diversity and division which you have historically had in this society. How do you get past where the abused white workers and the abused black workers and the abused immigrant groups find some place to come together to make it analogous to what you're talking about in the Nordic model?
Mm-hmm. One place to look is, how did they pull it off in the United Auto Workers? Right? Because that was a while back. And racism was not on the agenda in the 30s in the way that it then became in the 60s. And the United Auto Workers knew that the only route to success, because the workforce of the auto industry was both black and white, was to get to end this playing off of each other against each other, right? But to get the unity. And they did do that. And they did some of the most glorious people power stuff, right? Including taking over entire factories, right? They're doing the sit-down movement and so on. And they built one of the most powerful unions in the country based on the unity. So the little I know about that, I wish I knew more, is that they kept stressing, they kept making transparent the nature of the oppression. That is, that the company's management was counting on blacks and whites not getting along and finding fault with each other and so on and so on, distrusting each other. And that as long as we fight each other, then we can't fight management, and then management will get us both. That needs to be writ large in our country, right? And there's been a real reluctance to do that. We do have, thanks to Occupy, I think we can now say, I've been getting away with saying since July, from, in North Dakota and in Alaska, just all kinds of places, I've been getting away with referring casually to the economic elite. And nobody's thrown a stone at me yet. And sometimes I'll even say 1%. There is, my guess is that there's a growing understanding that we have a management. That it's not just on a scholarly level, but that there's a growing appreciation of that. And that that many of the people who voted for Trump also understand that. And many of the people, based on polls, who identify themselves as Tea Party members also know that. So I think it is a growing consciousness among people at large that we have a management, and that the only way we're going to push that management out is to get together across these lines that otherwise divide us. But it's nip and tuck, because there's another thing going on as well, right? It will be interesting. It'll be interesting to see how much we can participate in that ourselves. One of the things I notice in the retrospective after the vote, after the election, is blaming of white working class men who voted for Trump as the reason why we're in trouble now. I noticed that blaming to be popular among middle class liberals and professional people. And it's being one way that's being expressed in today's Philadelphia Inquirer. It's on the editorial page, a long article by a Harvard scholar railing against populism and saying this is the problem, and so on and so on. And the last paragraph is, so we have to restore the integrity and strength of the political parties. She means two political parties, right? In order to be a bulwark against this populism that's taking us over, and that is this, you know, scamming the white working class, which, you know, and so on and so on. There's also a front page article in today's Inquirer. Top banner headline starts this article, and it's an analysis of the election, and it's interviews with white working class, usually men, sometimes women, about do you know who Trump has appointed for this? And how in bed they are with the Wall Street. And do you know who? And do you know this? And do you know this? Asking all kinds of sort of factoids that only political junkies actually pay close attention to. This journalist was asking over and over and over whether people understand the background of these who were appointed to Commerce Secretary and this and that and the other thing. And the nature of the article is these people, who some of whom had not finished high school, but who had voted for Trump, have no idea what they did, and therefore it's their fault, and therefore that's the trouble, and we're going to pay this high penalty for the next 4 years. The country is going to pay this terrible price for the next 4 years for these ignorant people, some of whom had never voted before in their lives, and dare to come forward and vote for Trump. And now they don't even know what he's doing. And it just goes to show you how terrible it is to be at the mercy of white, uneducated, working class people. It's really quite worth going online and finding this. Big blame game going on. So it's both on the mass media front, on the front page, and then in the editorial page, it's there by a Harvard scholar. And it's all about, we know who the enemy is. The enemy, we, that's we, you know, who is we, right? We, middle class, we, college educated people, we know that we are the victims of white working class people, right? It's so insidious. So part of the political problem we're facing here is that college educated people, and I say this as somebody who's just, you know, spent 7 years in college, have not done our homework with regard to this phenomenon of class. In other words, we haven't learned from the UAW that class can be more important in understanding life, say, in an auto factory, than race. Right? So ignoring class, as white middle class people tend to do, then it's very easy to get sucked into this blame game. Well, let's blame working class people for a situation that was really engineered by management, you know, overall. So I've shorthanded that, and you might want to go, and it's a little bit irrelevant to the Nordic thing, except that something that's very refreshing about the political discourse in all four of those countries that I've studied is that when I ask people about a contemporary thing, like, oh, yesterday there was a vote in your parliament to this effect, da 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 da, and it seemed like it was da da da. Is that right? They said, well, you see, in that case, the Farmers' Party was voting in this way because it'll have this kind of implication for the farmers, whereas the Labor Party, and then the Christian Democrats, they were concerned, and they'll just line out these various interests. And the discourse is an interest-based discourse, rather than a big sort of ideological, you know, freedom or something like that. And and we tend not to talk that way about politics. We tend not to talk in terms of, there's this new trade deal coming out. Whose interest does this advance, you know, and whose interest going to be lost and stuff like that? So I think that what am I really saying? What was the basic question? I got off on a rant. It had to
do. I can remind you if you'd like. It had to do with how do we build a unified vision when there is opposition and polarization, not just among left and right, but there's diversity in white working class, immigrant workers, and African Americans, both working and not.
Right. So I agree that there's diversity, and that is a challenge. And I guess I was also bringing the challenge to us in the room, who I'm guessing are more professional, middle class people, and saying that I think that we also have not sort of caught up with that sensibility about class that UAW had. And that makes it tough for us to be there when things are happening that that could be really helpful. Time for a different cluster, the cluster in the back. Yay.
Thank you. And as you can hear, I'm from a slightly fringe-like Nordic place. getting more fringe by the year, unfortunately. I wanted to ask you how you think the wonderful Nordic model can be scaled up to something the size of the US, and also to mention a short but powerful word that I'm surprised hasn't come up yet, which is tax.
Yes.
Obviously, we know that the Nordic countries are high tax.
High tax.
And what do you think would persuade countries like yours or mine to face a higher tax burden? The broad picture of all those wonderful things you talked about might be a fantastic, huge vision, but would it be more effective to focus on a particular vision, such as better healthcare for all, to persuade people about the tax question?
Oh, so glad you raised those questions, because they will come up with your neighbors, right? And the people in your meeting are saying, well, yeah, but what about the taxes? And what about the scale? So I'm really grateful. I had my own skepticism on both of those that I took with me to do the research. So in one research outfit in Oslo, as I was about to go into a conference room to interview two of the lead researchers, I noticed on the wall in the hallway a framed photograph, a number of framed photographs, but one of them showed a bunch of people who looked Chinese to me. So I turned to them and I said, these people look Chinese. And they said, yes, they were from Beijing, they were sent by the People's Republic of China to Norway to interview us and interview all over the place to learn more about our economic system. And my jaw drops open, right? Like, what? And they saw my expression and they said, we wondered the same thing. And so as soon as we took them into the conference room and sat them down, we said, why are you here? Because we were wondering, how could you be? China, after all, makes the United States look small. Right? It is really, really big country. And it also makes the US look homogeneous. China is far more heterogeneous than the US. So why would economists and policymakers come to tiny Norway to learn stuff for them? So they asked that question. And the Chinese said, right, you're concerned about scale and so on. And we want to say that from our point of view, in terms of economics, some things in the economy do scale up and some things don't. So we're here to look for things that are working for you. We think of you as kind of a little laboratory trying stuff out. So we're looking for the things that work for you that we might be able to scale up in China. Maybe nationally, but maybe regionally, and maybe on province level. And then, and with regard to the economy, some things are culturally influenced, that is influenced by the culture of the people it applied to, and some things are not. And so again, we're very pragmatic. We're just asking with regard to everything that you do that's successful, will it fly in China? Or maybe it'll fly with that part of the population, but not that part. So that really gave me some things to think about. And again, I always love taking the lens over there and applying it to my own country. So I got to thinking, Social Security. Now that's a system that works just great in Iceland with 320,000 people. And it works fine with the United States of America. I mean, it's stingier here than it is there. But the system, as far as we know, nobody sends their Social Security check back saying, well, I'm of a different religion, or my skin is different color, so I don't want this money. As far as I know, that's not a problem, right? It seems like Social Security is a very valued system. When it was introduced as a proposal, of course, it was fought like crazy. Resisted like crazy, it'll never work. It's foreign import from Europe, it'll never work here, and so on and so on. And of course now it works so brilliantly that it's really, really important to Ryan to try to grab it and turn it over to Wall Street. Another example would be Medicare, right? Again, there were people saying, oh, this is terrible, it's a communist plot, and so on and so on. Never work in the United States. And the studies show that people who are on Medicare are much more satisfied than they were previously when they were on private health care, health insurance. Medicare is a superior system. So I would say, here's another example. People in New York City used to enjoy free higher education, the most diverse city in the country. So I would just say, and the largest city in the country. So I would just say, let's be like the Chinese. Let's look at those places as laboratories that have tried this, tried that. Some things work. Let's see if they work out here. They may work as well as Social Security and so on. And then the tax question. All right. It's a major obstacle that in this country we've come to the view that, it is held by some people that the free market is always the best way to get things done. They are way more pragmatic than that. In fact, one reason why I think it's an appropriate vision for us to peddle here in this country is because it's based so much on pragmatism. So they say, okay, it's useful to have a market. Flexibility, a lot of flexibility in a market. But there are things that a market does well and things that a market does very poorly. So you just need to figure out what's what. So with regard to healthcare, clearly a market won't work. It's terrible. And so in the United States, for example, we pay one-third more because we're market-based. We pay one-third more, terribly inefficient, terribly wasteful. And it doesn't even help most people, many people anyway. So the market is clearly the wrong place to put healthcare. The most efficient way, efficient way, as well as effective way, is to tax people for healthcare and then put the tax back out, and that's the way to do it. Same with same with education. The most efficient way, no doubt, is to tax people. The Swedes took a flirtation. Another fun thing about the Nordics is you can watch them try stuff, try experiments, and see how they work. The Swedes got excited by charter schools for a while. So they put charter schools into their school system, and they tried it for 8-10 years. And they said, what a mistake. This is a mess. It's so inefficient. It's, you know, profits being drained off. And the youngsters are getting an inferior education because the teacher's not being paid enough, because they can't be, and still profits be going to the Danish corporations that are running these charter schools. It was really funny. So clearly, So of course, so there are a lot of things you get better done if you tax people to do them, and so on. Now it raises, though, the question of trust. Why should we trust the government to do well with our money? Well, 100 years ago, they didn't trust their governments either. And they shouldn't have, any more than we should trust our governments. Because our government, as their governments were 100 years ago, our government's run by the 1%. And the 1% doesn't seem nearly as interested in our well-being as it is in its bank accounts. And so there's no reason for us to pay more taxes to people who would spend it on themselves, including on the military, which is itself a wealth redistribution mechanism, because who owns the arms manufacturers who sop up all that tax money from us? So they distrusted their governments 100 years ago. Then they created democratic systems through this big fight they had with their 1%. They pushed their 1% out of control, out of the historic dominance. They took over their countries, majority of people, and then they could trust their government. They could trust their governments because they ran their governments. And then they said, wait, you ought to have lots of money so you can do the right thing with it. That's how it works. Yeah. Oh, he's actually calling it, I guess, because he can see better than I.
Thank you. Earlier you talked about we need to create a vision. And I think that's very important so that we have something, a banner to walk under, so to speak. I would like to bring two points, and then I have two questions. For me, respect and dignity must be part of that vision. Respect for other people and human dignity. If we don't include that in our vision, we have a problem. And it also helps to work in another way than pushing off against the other ones. Right. The second point is some of these basic principles are already written in 1946 in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Nothing new in the sun. So my question is, why has nothing happened yet? My second question is, are you a good skater?
I'm not a good skater. And I'm not a good skier either. Right. Well, in the last chapter, I cite a number of polls that show the majority of Americans pretty much lining up with the Human Rights Declaration, pretty much believing in the same kinds of things that the Nordic people believe in. So that's one reason why I think this is a model that can be accepted by a majority of Americans. Because when they're asked by pollsters about their opinions on this, that, and the other thing, over and over and over, they say a majority says yes. And so the reason why we don't have those things, a study that I cite was done out of Princeton, in which 1,700 and some, I think 741 decisions made on a federal level were examined over a 20-year period to about 2002, looking at all those decisions that were made on a federal level and asking which decisions was there agreement between the majority and the economic elite. And there were a number of decisions like that. There was a general broad agreement. And which of the decisions which the majority felt one way and the economic elite felt a different way? And in those cases, the scholars were wondering, who got their way? What would be your guess?
The
the elite in almost every case. Almost every case. So they thought, well, maybe we're not taking into account AARP and NAACP and, you know, these sort of mass-based Sierra Club and so on, all these different organizations that, you know, that that aggregate individuals into a collective force. And it didn't make a difference. So, I mean, the fight got a little longer and bigger, but the economic elite still got its way overwhelmingly in almost all cases. So they came to the conclusion that if by democracy we mean majority rules, that's not what we've got in the United States. And when BBC covered it, they called it the oligarchy study, which isn't actually a word that the Princeton studies used, but it's for shorthand pretty good. It's we are run by an oligarchy like the Nordics were before. So the Nordic, if the economic elite of the Nordic countries was still running those countries, they wouldn't, I mean, they would have huge poverty like we do, like they did 100 years ago. They would have a mess like we have. And the reason they don't was because they took the step of pushing the 1% out so that they could have a democracy. And that's the step we forgot to take. Ah, yes.
Although I'm going to be cognizant of the time.
Oh, it's just about time
and
to wrap up.
Since I took almost 10 minutes of prime time to make an advert, I think we'll extend it by 10 minutes anyway, but you probably will want to have some time to sign books.
Sign books.
Yes.
Yes.
Because you'll find a lot of the answers to your questions in the books. As one who has read this book, I can assure you that it's very comprehensive. Did you call on this gentleman first?
Jonathan.
I'm sorry.
I just want to say I read the book and I love it. And I, as always, I really enjoy your storytelling and the way in which you weave together stories into a coherent vision. And it's very inspiring to me. One of the things that I found powerful was your framing of the story of the Nordic model as a story of seeking freedom. And I've been thinking a lot about how could that frame, how could that insight be useful in engaging with people given the dominance of the theme of freedom in rhetoric that doesn't necessarily match support that vision in the mythology or in the discourse in this country. So that's something I've been chewing on, and you may have thoughts about that. I also have a question about, again, the Nordic model is in the context of a growth economy. Mm. And that raises, for me, that also raises some interesting questions about sustainability and long-term, and I don't know if you have any comments there.
Thank you for both of those. Yeah, they are not utopia. They are not utopia. And one of the ways they're not utopia is this growth imperative. Now, what they have done, especially in Denmark, that's the place I'm more sure of, is de-linked energy increase with GDP increase. It used to be in order to have GDP growth, you needed to have energy growth, which meant more consumption of energy, which is problematic, right? More emissions and so on and so on. In Denmark, they de-linked it. So the growth curve for the economy continues to grow like that, but the energy curve goes like that. Yeah. So that's a considerable achievement. And that's why actually all four of those countries now have set goals, national goals, for being carbon neutral. The most advanced being Norway, which was afraid it was going to be outdone by Sweden. The Swedish parliament was getting very frisky about setting a soon goal for carbon neutrality. So the Norwegians had a parliamentary meeting this summer and decided on 2030 as their goal. But Copenhagen is already saying, no doubt, we're going to be the first capital in the world to go carbon neutral entirely. So, you know, what we have at Friends Center in Philadelphia, there are entire nations that are setting what look like realistic goals to achieve that. But that's still not what you're talking about. You're talking about something more advanced than that, and there are active fights going on about that. Greenpeace in every one of those countries, for example, especially in Norway, keep the oil in the ground. Do not go into the Arctic and take the gas. No, no, no. So very exciting, and I describe that in the book. And then the first question was about freedom. I'm still experimenting with that. Like one thing I'll try is to say, I love freedom. How many of you love freedom? Well, you know what? I found out that in Scandinavia, people have more individual freedom than we do. What do you think of that? I love freedom. And I want all of you to have as much freedom as anybody in the world. Wouldn't that be so cool? And for our children to know that they are growing up in the freest society in the world. But we don't have that. They're actually a lot freer in making their life decisions in Scandinavia. Even the entrepreneurs are freer. There's more startups in Norway than there are in the United States. So what's up with that? Wouldn't you like to be just as good as they are in terms of individual freedom? And so I experiment with stuff like that. And I would love it if you all did experiment with that with your neighbors and other people you know, and just see what works for you in terms of entering the discourse through the individual freedom route, because as Jonathan says, so many people are obsessed with freedom. I am, but I mean, a lot of people are in that country, right? And it keeps being used by the right wing as the argument for this system, and it's so bogus, of course, on their part. Because they're very happy to abrogate freedom at any moment about any particular thing. So that's probably it, right? One last one.
I think one more.
Yeah.
I saw this lady.
And then we can talk over the book, right? Yeah.
Yeah, my question relates to small businesses. How do they work with, say, vacation pay? And when you only have one to, say, 10 employees, are you responsible for all those get 5 weeks paid vacation, or how does that all work with the benefits, or they come all from the government? Because I can see how they work with large corporations or government-run companies, but how do a lot of these benefits work for companies that only have one or two employees or 10 employees?
Well, it's the law, actually. So all of the business plan needs to account for that.
So yeah. If you have... So your business plan, are you just going to pay them a wage that you can work in? Because how do you have, around here, most people wouldn't want to have their employee going for 5 weeks if they only had a couple employees.
You know, right.
If you're running a small restaurant or something like that, and then you have to give that person five weeks off during whatever certain time.
But you'd have to stagger it and so on, right, and get temporary help to be able to go, you know, if you had two overlapping, that kind of thing.
And when you have part-time help, do you have to give them the same benefits that you have to give full-time help?
I don't know that. I don't know on the benefits level.
Because I was just thinking that would be, you know, around here a lot of people, a lot of companies like McDonald's and stuff try to only, in Walmart, they only try to hire people, you know, a certain amount of hours, mm-hmm. You have to give as much benefits. Is that something
now, of course, some benefits are provided by this taxation system, right? So a huge benefit in a country is health care, and that's provided. Mm-hmm. So employers don't have to worry about health care. They don't have to worry about pensions because that's provided. They don't have to care about child care because that's built in by this system, the larger system. So, yeah, wages are high. McDonald's workers in Copenhagen earn $20 an hour. Yeah, so wages are high. People enter their work life at a high level, and then they don't go all that high for the most part. Basically, one of the ways that they dealt with poverty was they used to have an income spread like us, a huge, you know, huge wealth gap, and they did this to it. So. So these people are sitting pretty, no doubt. Many millions of dollars and so on. And these people are doing fine. So it's like that. Equality, equality. It's in our Constitution or something. So there's so much more. And I do have, I did put footnotes actually in the book, even though I was trying my best to write like a New Yorker writer. I didn't succeed entirely, but I tried. And anyway, people tell me it's a bit of a page turner, and there are footnotes. So you'll find a lot of studies and so on that you can, you know, that will help you to pursue some of those questions some more. But I want to just thank you for tremendous attention and great questions. You asked me hard questions.
Thank you. A round of applause for George. Thank you so much, George.
You're so welcome. You're so welcome. Meet you back here.
So if we give George a chance to get back to his table, and we also have refreshments. There's somebody probably knows what they are, actually. Has anyone seen them? Pardon?
I have to get a real
banana cake and decaffeinated coffee and tea back in the kitchenette. So take your questions and give them to George, buy his book and have him sign it, and then we'll convene for some Broadway singing after you all exhaust the supply of George's book. Thank you so much for coming out tonight.